Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Hot Water by D.N. Erikson, narrated by Candace Fitzgerald. 1. Present.
So, have you come to your decision, Tess?
The ferryman stares back at me after his monologue, raising one bushy white eyebrow as he plays with one of the vials sitting on the chestnut desk in front of him. The back room is furnished like any middle-class accountant's office. Two leather chairs for visitors on my side of the desk, beige wall-to-wall carpet, and slightly off-white walls. The only thing unusual is the map of Ragnarok hanging behind his stooped shoulders. It blinks and updates in real time, a magically enhanced tracking system, keeping tabs on some of the town's inhabitants. There are hundreds of little dots going about their lives. Aside from the blinking town map, the only other noteworthy thing about this place is the smell. Given that I'm in the basement of an abandoned gym, I'd expect some aroma, stale sweat, dust. But when I pull in another breath, all I get is nothingness. There were wards guarding the doors that led to this hidden room. Could be some sort of magic blanketing it in a sterile scent. I wonder, as I look into his yellow eyes, whether I'm one of the dots he's been keeping tabs on. I won't give you Javi. I pant the words, still trying to catch my breath. Getting here was a bit of a trial. The ferryman's blank expression doesn't change. His wrinkled fingers are steepled on the desktop.
That's rather unfortunate to hear, Miss Skye.
Sweat drips from my brow as I glare back at the alchemist. My skin is still clammy thanks to almost being steamed alive in the adjacent room a couple minutes prior. He's completely calm, as if boiling people in basements is just a normal Thursday afternoon. Who knows? Maybe it is for him. The ferryman is a broker of magus and anima, the two core magical elements. A conduit between low-life dirtbags and just as despicable elitist scumbags. He acquires objects and creatures, then uses his alchemical skills to break them down into their raw magical essence. The ferryman flicks an invisible piece of dust from his custom-tailored suit.
If you won't bring me, Detective Diaz, then I believe we have little else to discuss at this time.
The ferryman does well for himself. He doesn't need the sale. But you don't get into this type of work simply for the money. You do it at least partly for the thrill. I cock my head at the noise coming from the floor above. Footsteps slap against the concrete. I sure didn't call the cops, but it sounds like the cavalry is here.
I think they're coming for you,
I say. But he doesn't care. He seems pretty sure they won't catch him, even if it looks like there's no way out.
I've made arrangements,
the ferryman says as he gathers up the four vials of anima, the ones he plans to sell later today, once he completes the set. There are five immortals, after all, Javi Diaz being the last one alive. These four vials contain the others' souls. He wants the fifth, Javi's. Hence the little chat we're currently having.
What happens to your little anima and magus brokerage business when chaos swallows the world?
Because the way I see it, without the immortals in the right place, we have a real problem. The ferryman just stares through me as he slides the vials into his suit pocket.
We all have our roles to play in this world, Miss Skye, and the world's security is not my concern.
He rises stiffly from the chair and walks slowly around the hefty desk. He smooths a non-existent wrinkle out of the fabric before reaching back into his pocket. The ferryman extracts an aluminum steel card identical to the one that brought me here. God damn me and my insatiable curiosity.
and urges to run off by myself. Then he leans over and presses the card's sharp edge against my cheek. It bites into my flesh as he rakes it across the skin.
"Do give me a call before it's too late."
He places the bloodied card in front of me on the desk. "Otherwise,
there is much I can do with anima of this power.
Such as?
Find you again should you decline my offer."
The ferryman checks his watch.
"Before midnight, Miss Skye."
"Don't hold your breath." I rub my sleeve against my cheek to wipe off the blood. It does little to stem the tide. Drip, drip, drip. The blood adds a nice crimson accent to the beige rug beneath my leather boots. The ferryman doesn't seem to mind, though.
"Oh, I wouldn't be so sure."
He leans in next to my ear. "Because have you ever wondered why Detective Diaz came to Ragnarok in the first place?" "No, that's a lie. It's something I've been wondering all day." But I don't get a response. When I turn around, the ferryman is gone, leaving me to wonder how I got into this mess, and how the fuck I'm ever going to get out. 2. 24 hours ago. Like most shitty cases, this dumpster fire began with an anonymous call. The phone rang and rang atop the scattered papers on my cramped office desk. I stared at the unfamiliar number glowing on the screen, reluctant to answer. With two exceptions, I'd been avoiding new cases since Mom had come cannonballing back into my life a couple months ago. The first was Reg's murder. The second, well, let's just say, if I ever had to go back to the Ragnarok Supernatural Anthropological Museum, it'd be too soon. Otherwise, I'd been holed up in my office. But I wasn't working. Maybe I was still processing her return and the associated betrayal. Maybe I was seeing non-existent patterns. All the shit with Mom had started with a phone call from an unknown number, too. Maybe I was just tired. At least the soul shock was a thing of the past. The fragmentary visions I'd been experiencing after soul walking and then dying in Reg Samuel's ruined body had stopped. The second potion Javi's navigator friend Carl had given me had done the trick. I hadn't seen anything in a couple months. There must have been something about seeing Javi's pain in the memory we experienced together. Feeling it, as he realized his fellow immortals had had their souls taken, and the bodies that lay on the warehouse floor were just empty vessels. Then the anger directed toward who had taken the souls. Mom. Or maybe the potion just flushed some residual toxins from my system. Who knew how magic really worked after all? Suffice to say, the soul shock experience proved to be quite the trippy roller coaster ride from ailment to cure. And while enlightening, I was not eager to be ejected into some weird limbo as pure consciousness again, or start hallucinating. The phone stopped ringing as I emerged from my thoughts. Then it started again. Ella's large paw batted against my bare leg beneath the chair. She had remained with me as Toby's rehab continued. It was hard for him to care for a massive dog in his current state.
"Please answer, Tessie. I am trying to sleep."
"Oh, I'm sorry. Had a long day of doing nothing, have we?" The husky growled, the throaty sound rumbling through the floor. But she was right. I couldn't hide forever. Private investigators do one thing: investigate. Without a case, who was I? So on the third ring, I picked up and said, "Tess Skye Investigations, this is Tess speaking."
"The Tess Skye?"
It was a woman with a high-pitched, nasally voice. She didn't offer any sort of introduction. "I don't know about that," I said. "But sure, Who's calling?
You brought down a police captain, the woman said. Don't sell yourself short.
And let me guess, you're an old friend who's pissed about it, I said, wary about what might be coming next. I'd been getting shit from some people on the local force about not having their back. The woman laughed.
Stella Reynolds got exactly what she deserved.
True enough. But my involvement in that particular case hadn't exactly been high-profile news. The feds had taken most of the credit for saving Ragnarok from the psychotic billionaire Dominic Rillo and the corrupt Captain Reynolds. So it wasn't exactly the kind of career-making case that would lead to me being dubbed the Tess Skye, unless you were someone really in the know. My money was on law enforcement. I'm guessing you're a cop. The woman unleashed a snort.
I have some connections.
Her tone grew serious.
It's 24 years before our dear former captain is eligible for parole, even with the plea bargain, she said. That's a lot of time.
Thanks for the update, I said. What do you want exactly?
Help,
the woman said.
With a matter of the most personal kind.
I braced myself for the whole, my husband is cheating on me and I don't know what to do kind of shtick. It had grown old over time. That was a complete lie. It had grown old before the first time I heard it. Fortunately, or unfortunately perhaps, that wasn't where this call was headed.
I have an interesting dilemma, the woman said. And I thought, given your track record, that you were the woman to help me solve it.
Lay it out for me, I said.
Not over the phone. You need to see it in person.
I don't do Easter egg hunts.
You'll want to make an exception, she insisted. It's right in your wheelhouse.
This conversation couldn't get much more ambiguous or strange, so I said, since you know me so well, why don't you tell me what my wheelhouse is?
High profile, big publicity, career making.
I don't think you know me as well as you seem to think, I said. The attention and accolades were more stifling than anything else.
Then you'd be wrong, Tess, because I've seen your destiny, and it is.
Which is when I hung up and returned to the papers adorning my desk. Taxes, invoices, financial records. You know, fun stuff. Life's too short for nonsense. Destinies aside, my mystery caller was right about one thing. I'd caught a couple spotlight-worthy cases lately. I might have ended up as a footnote by choice on the Rillo episode, but there'd been plenty of ink spilled regarding my involvement in the Emmy Davis and Reg Samuels cases. And then there was that incident where some psycho trapped me in the museum and live-streamed the whole thing. Don't worry, I kicked her ass pretty good and looked like a badass. But the end result of all this publicity? Envelopes and media kits piled high in the corner, threatening to topple over into Ella's stainless steel water bowl. You track down the most famous shifter in the world after 2 years, and that star rubs off on you, whether you want it to or not. Then you follow that up by cracking the death of a charismatic leader of a pseudo-cult, and the buzz grows. But I hadn't granted anyone an ounce of FaceTime. No on-screen interviews, no podcasts. I wasn't big on the spotlight. Occupational hazard of being a soul walker. Too much unwanted attention was a threat to not just me, but the greater good. In the wrong hands, my abilities could easily be exploited, which I'd spent the last year learning, having been blackmailed by Rillo to do his dirty work. Otherwise, he would have poisoned the whole town. Few people know about my abilities, but if these media vultures kept poking around, that would change. And I'd already been forced to assist one sociopath. I didn't need dozens more on my tail. The phone rang again. Unknown caller. It dawned on me that this woman might be a reporter. I shivered, despite the humidity in the cramped office. Then I pressed the side button to mute the call. This lady might not have been a psychopath. She might not have even been media. Maybe she had a legitimate case, but I didn't do goose chases or riddles. Either tell me what it's about or find another investigator. The phone chimed, indicating I had a voicemail. Ella grunted in the corner, sleep temporarily disrupted by the noise, but she had a remarkable ability to block things out, so her eyes never opened. Must have been nice. I didn't have that luxury. I stared at the voicemail notification until the phone's screen went dark. Then, with a sigh, I listened to it. It was the same woman as before. The voicemail, unlike our vague conversation minutes earlier, was straight to the point.
"My name is Serena Adams," she said, "and there's a body in the basin that you'll want to see."
That got my attention. My shoulders stiffened. There was a long pause on the recording, then the final coup de grace.
"And when the tally hits 3, you're next, Tess."
3. I set the phone down on the messy desk, trying to gather my thoughts. My heart pounded and my fingertips buzzed as I played with the sprawling papers. Unprovoked threats of serial murder were new and novel, and she had sounded serious. But one can never be too sure. Back when I was a cop, we responded to more than one or two bogus calls. So I thumped in a quick internet search for the name Serena Adams. To my surprise, a slew of recent news stories popped up. I tapped the first result with the seemingly clickbaity headline, "Architect of Doom Flees Miami PD Custody Mid-Trial, Currently at Large," and began skimming the days-old article. My initial impression about it being sensational proved incorrect. The headline was accurate. Apparently, Serena Adams had once worked as a designer of supernatural jails and other holding facilities requiring special security measures to contain non-human creatures. She'd been so good at her job, in fact, that she'd received awards. She'd had a thriving design firm. The article contained multiple images illustrating her fall from grace, the typical mugshot with the accused looking like they'd spent the last 11 days sleeping with a colony of flea-bitten stray dogs, then a slick promotional image pulled from her site farther down the page, designer heel dangling off her crossed leg as she sat on her immaculate desk, the Miami waterfront stretching out beyond the crystal-clear window. And finally, a shot of the jail cell with a hawk-sized hole blown clear through the wall. From her escape. What had landed her in jail was the secret sauce behind how she'd managed to design such airtight facilities. Her firm had been testing them with real creatures. Not ones, mind you, who had committed any crimes, but that they had kidnapped and imprisoned. And it was suspected, later disposed of. Hence the nickname Architect of Doom. Her test facility had yet to be located. She had denied all the charges and pled not guilty. Based on the article, though, the trial hadn't been going her way. So she'd bolted 2 days ago. But none of that explained what she was doing in Ragnarok. A long way from South Beach. Or why she'd dropped a body in the basin. Or why I'd made her hit list. But one thing was clear. Serena Adams was a dangerous lady. I dialed Javi Diaz. The detective picked up on the first ring.
"Hey, Tess,"
he said in his whiskey-smooth voice. Did you guys find anything out in the basin this morning?
Did Ned call you about that?
So it was true. No, why would Ned call me?
Don't worry about it, Javi said. How'd you hear about it?
Because I just got a weird call, I said. Really weird.
Really weird how?
I filled him in about Serena Adams, the body dump, and the threat of more bodies, including mine. After I was finished with the summary, he said,
That's a hell of a story, Tess.
The news articles are legit, at least. Search online. There's dozens of them. He tapped on his keyboard.
System says there's a bolo out for her. Huge priority from the looks of it. New addition to the FBI's most wanted list.
No shit, I said with a low whistle. So you want to check it out?
Did you sign the paperwork yet?
Since when has a little red tape stopped us?
Since you keep making bigger and bigger messes,
Javi said,
and fewer friends around here.
I sighed and brushed through the paper stack until I found the contract in question. The header was labeled Ragnarok Police Department Consultants Agreement. You know, if I wanted my old job back, I'd have just signed back on after the Rillo case. Ragnarok PD had offered me my old detective gig then. I'd turn them down.
The new captain was pretty clear about things, Javi said. You sign the package they're offering or...
Yeah, I'm persona non grata around the precinct and will be shot on sight.
Not quite that dramatic, Javi said. Maybe just tossed in a holding cell.
I dug my nails into the sheet, crumpling it slightly. Just let me know what you found.
After you sign.
Come on.
Javi snorted. I tell you now, you go off on your own and you get in trouble.
Since when are you a stickler for the rules?
Since I need your help with this one, and I'm gonna have a hell of a time getting that if the department shuts you out, partner.
Aw, you say the nicest things. I could almost feel myself blushing.
So, is that a yes?
Fine, I'll sign the stupid thing. The call ended, leaving me to grapple with my next decision, whether or not to accept Ragnarok PD's rather generous consulting package. Not as an official employee of the local government, purely as an independent contractor, like when they needed a second opinion. The pay was good, actually pretty damn close to my salary when I was a cop, and the retainer was for only one case a month, 6-month contract. Guaranteed cash flow, access to public resources, although really, I already had those courtesy of Javi. And the big one, friends on the force, or at least not actively at my throat. It wouldn't be a bad thing to have the cops back on my side. I'd ruffled a few feathers recently, what with sending Brad to the morgue and Manny up the river to the big house. Couple that with jailing Captain Stella Reynolds, and more than a few people saw me as an enemy of the badge. Not most. But every group has its diehards. You know, stick together no matter what. Handle things internally, even when you're dealing with corrupt murderers. It was a good enough deal, and I was basically a consultant already anyway, just without the pay from the department. And I could keep doing my own stuff, too. Hell, it might bring my business even with Sherlock Anderson's, without being a total piece of shit. Then again, his business had taken a real hit after the Emmy Davis stuff. So I scrawled my pen over the bottom of the sheet and signed. Then I scanned a picture of the paperwork and shot it off to the department's email. Guess I was in for the next 6 months and 6 cases. My phone chimed. Email confirmation from the department that they'd received my signed contract. Not 2 minutes later, the phone rang again. Department phone number. I answered with, Hello?
Hey, Tess, this is Ned Jacobs, the voice said. Everything okay?
You know, Ned, the one who booked Manny and Brad that night you brought them in, pulled my service weapon on you. Sorry about that. No hard feelings. There was a long, awkward pause. There a problem with the paperwork? Never was my favorite thing on the force, paperwork. That sentiment had not changed since going the solo route. No, nothing wrong. There's just a note in the system saying to call you once the contract came through, labeled urgent. Ah, this was what Javi had been talking about. Someone was pretty confident I was going to say yes, huh? I said. I guess, Ned said with a nervous laugh. But yeah, the note says to ask you to come down to the morgue ASAP. I breathed a sigh of relief. Is it about anything in particular? A body just came in that was linked to an old case where you and Diaz were the lead detectives. Ned didn't need to explain further. I knew the case he was talking about. There's always at least one that haunts you. Every cop knows that. You can see the puzzle, but the pieces never quite fit together or line up perfectly. That's how this case was. This is the body in the basin they found this morning? Yes. And I said, what, same MO? And Ned replied, no, you remember Shane Gardner. Lead suspect, total dirtbag, I said. They found him, dead. Ned swallowed hard. And that's not all. What is that? It came with a note, he said, that this was just the first. I hung up, cracked my neck. It seemed my very first case was rearing its head and coming back with a vengeance. 4. A little more than 2 years ago, I'd made detective. I'd been assigned to partner with Javi Diaz. It wasn't his first case, not by a long shot, but it had been mine. And it had been a nightmare. There had been 5 previous bodies found with the same MO. Javi had already been working on it for a couple months by the time I'd sauntered into Ragnarok PD, bright-eyed and still somewhat naive after being a beat cop. That had changed fast. This hadn't just been a first case. It had been a baptism. In the hottest, harshest, most scalding water possible. As I pulled into the precinct's lot to check out Shane Gardner's body, blue skies shimmering above, my emotions were mixed. On one hand, we had always liked him for the murders. On the other hand, this was dredging up memories I'd rather have kept buried. Because we'd never been able to nail the bastard. I shoved my hands in my pockets to guard against the nip of the cold as I ducked into the morgue. This had never been my favorite place. Then again, I'd have to be pathologically insane, or just a pathologist, for that to be true. Ammonia and solvents punched me in the nose as I entered, like a hospital ward got into a fight with a taxidermist's workbench. Concrete floors stretched out beneath the single stainless steel slab. Shane Gardner's corpse was on top, sliced open. Ragnarok didn't rack up a huge body count, so the morgue at the police precinct didn't exactly have room for tons of autopsies at once. The wall had just 3 cold chambers. The pathologist hunched over the corpse, wheeled around, and said, oh, no, 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 no. Hey, Jenkins. I shot him a fake smile, showing all my teeth. Long time. Not long enough. Jenkins looked around, but I was the only one there. With a self-assured nod, he reached into his pocket and took out his phone. I'm calling upstairs. You do that, I said. But they're the ones who called me down here about Gardner.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.